Hello, everyone. How are you doing this evening? Good. Thank you all for joining us this evening. Hanifa Durabki bio is in the front cover of you all's program. We urge you all to read this so that you know how lucky we are to have a state gem with us. Hanif is an Ohioan who is in constant conversation with other artists, musicians, and writers through podcasts, poetry, and processes. His conversation reminds us that no matter one's age, race, or gender, we share much more than what we think. And at a time when the world is in so much pain, these are the conversations that will begin the healing processes. Tonight's event could not have taken place without the generous financial support of the following Central State units: Academic Affairs, the Colleges of Humanities, Arts, and Social Sciences, and the Honors College. We also want to thank Lisa Hess, the mind and heart behind restorativewisdom.org, a community of deepening listening in Ohio humanities, for believing in this idea and backing it up with their dollars. Tonight's presentation is possible because of the people who do the behind the scenes work, the ones who made this event run. So thank you to Bree Matthews, JC Jameson, Sherry Boffman, Rick Davis, and the crew at DHP. For the students and young people in the audience, we invite you all to listen to tonight's words because they celebrate Black performance. They celebrate music, arts, and all the things that we make us human in need of connection. Tonight is most of all for you. Before I invite Hanif to read, I'd like to remind you all to silence your phones and keep them stowed. Please do not record any portion of tonight's event. If you'd like to view tonight's event, the fireside chat and Q&A will be uploaded to YouTube shortly. And with that, I welcome Hanif Durabki.
Thank you.
Now we'll move into the fireside chat portion of the evening, where Hanif and Dr. Jenny Cruz, Professor of Music and Chair of the Fine and Performing Arts Department, will be in the conversation.
Thank you, Charles.
Thanks, Charles.
So, first of all, thank you for being here.
Yeah, this is a pleasure.
This is the second reading that I've listened to today. By the way, our shoes match.
Our shoes do match.
I'm very pleased. This is the second reading I heard today, and that's what gets me going, is hearing that. And I also know the first time you read this morning, it was like 10 a.m. So maybe you need a little time to get it going.
Yeah, this morning was tricky because I was also trying to accommodate. Thankfully, there was an interpreter in the audience for someone. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, I can't read at the normal pace I read because it's a little fast. And I'm one of those readers too, where if I'm reading at the pace, I'm in the pursuit of rhythm over perfection. Mm-hmm. And so if I'm reading and I mess up a word, sometimes I'll just keep going. Mm-hmm. I'll be like, they'll figure. one word is almost inconsequential if the pursuit is rhythm, right? I love a singer, this maybe is already going down a wild path, but I love a singer like, say, Mariah Carey, who in her prime would sometimes be like, you don't actually need to hear what this word is, you need to hear the sound it mm-hmm. could make, and you'll just arrive at it. Mm-hmm. Through that. Maybe that's my reading process too. I am prime Mariah Carey is what I'm saying. I'm like a prime.
So I had a plan for the first question, but now we're off on a rabbit hole. I love it. So I was watching you and you're dancing back there. There's this footwork you're doing and I could see your body's in the rhythm of what you're doing. And this morning, this young lady asked you, she said, do you get anxiety? How do you stay calm and even? And you shared, can you talk about the conductor metaphor? Because I think that would be a great setup for what I'm about to ask you.
I think that, so there's a lot of answers to that. But that was a good question because I think she's like, how do I stay calm, read my own poems? And I think that the answer I gave was that since you are the architect of the poem, you're also the conductor of the poem, right? You have to become one with the work when you're on stage and not be present in the world where everyone else is watching you. Because they are audience, and that is great. It is great to have an audience to the work. But for me, the best readings that I do are ones where I kind of don't know what's happening in a way. Like there's, I also talked about this perhaps on Instagram yesterday. There's like, does anyone know the movie For Love of the Game? It's a very, like a baseball rom-com. Sorry to reference a like Kevin Costner's third worst baseball movie. It's not a great movie, but there's this thing he does. He's a pitcher in the movie. And there's this thing he does before he goes to the mound where like the crowd is loud and he mumbles this thing, he goes, clear the mechanism, and everything goes quiet. And like it's just him and the person in front of him. And so for me, the act of reading and performing work is how do I build a world where it's only me and what is directly in front of me, which is the work itself. And that isn't done out of disdain for audience, right? I think that there are moments where if I were in a more expansive reading setting, I would be talking a lot more in between. Like I did a reading in Portland on Sunday that was like 2 hours long because in between I was talking with the audience. So I don't have a disdain for the audience, but in order for me to perform in the way that I want to, it is like how a conductor turns their back to the audience to make sure they are getting the best, it's so they're facing the actual instruments. Yeah. They're facing the music and making sure the music is coming out clearly to everyone who can see it. And so there's a kind of separation of self that I think I am required to engage in when performing, because otherwise I don't think I would be able to do it effectively.
So I'm a performer, I'm a musician, I'm a pianist, and hours go into the performance.
Yeah.
Like when you sit down, that's just like a hair of a percent of a point of what you've done to prepare for that. And yet every time I play a piece, it sounds different every single time. So what's happening for me is there's a preparation, there's an intent, there's a desire, but in the act of performing, there's constant revision where I like play a note and I'm like, oh, wait, ooh, and then I gotta do something different. So I'm not the poet, I'm not the composer, but in that moment, I'm the one creating in front of people. So with your own poetry, do you feel as if new things come out every time you perform it? Do you feel like, you know, your feet are moving back there and all of a sudden you're feeling it in a different way? How does that work for you?
I think so. I mean, I came up in Poetry Slam, in performance poetry, and that was really important for me because, and I didn't do that because one poet I look up to is a mentor of mine, the poet Scott Woods out of Columbus, and he ran a night called, still runs a night called Writer's Block Poetry Night, and if you wanted to participate in the Poetry Slam, you had to bring like a new poem or two every week. And like, I didn't, at this point, I was just getting into writing poems, and so I just needed a deadline. Like I didn't, without, you know, I've talked a lot today about how I'm pretty lazy but very disciplined. And so I knew, left to my own devices, I would never write a poem. But to have this looming deadline of like, if you want to do this, you gotta, you know. But what I loved about Poetry Slam was that you got real-time feedback.
Yeah.
It was an editing process that happened as you read poems out loud. You heard how an audience would respond to certain lines, or a line that you thought was good doesn't hit in the way you thought it did, or even the musicality of reading your work out loud takes on a different tone in that setting. I record, I still to this day, I used to back then, I still do now, I record myself in between drafts of my poems because sound and the voice is revelatory, right?
Yeah.
It's important to know what we're, I know a lot of people don't like the sound of their own voice, I don't like the sound of my own voice, but I still kind of endure that because every reflection we are met with, uncomfortable as they are, is revelatory.
Yeah.
Like, I don't particularly enjoy looking at myself in the mirror. I don't dislike it. I don't have some, like, horrible, you know, I'm not saying that because I feel bad about myself. I'm saying, like, I just don't spend a lot of time.
Yeah.
But I have, like, a really, I also have a very rigorous skincare routine. You know what I mean? And there's something about being confronted with those multiple, if I have to, like, be confronted with my reflection multiple times a day, because my skincare routine is an all-day thing, then I am being at least conscious of what I can't lie to myself.
Yeah. Well, you could.
I mean, I could, but then there's a harsh come down every time, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's in the same way that reflections are revelatory, that reflection of the voice back to the ear is revelatory.
Yeah.
And there are some words that are your words and some words that are just like not the music for your voice, right?
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean you can't use them. I mean, there are some words you certainly shouldn't use, you know what I mean? But I'm talking about like, words not in the problematic canon.
It feels like there's a lack of authenticity. Your voice says it, and you're like, no, that's not it. That's not it. That's not the right word. That's not where I'm going with this.
Yeah, and it's important to know just like each of us, this is a small delineation that only makes sense for my own editorial purposes, but people are always like, the voice is an instrument, and I get that as a process, but instead for me to think about how I approach the poem and editing and writing and revising, language is, for me, the instrument, and the voice is just the amplifier through which it travels, right? Mm-hmm. Because that allows me to ask myself better questions of what words sound good next to other words. It really breaks it down to the granular act of arranging mm-hmm. in this way that is present of how can I arrange this symphony of language? Because my voice alone can't do the work,
yeah.
right? My voice has very clear limits, yeah. you know?
That's the perfect, I mean, this is a perfect segue to my original first question, which is about time travel. So I can smell my mom's Estefau, and as soon as I smell it, I'm 7 years old again.
Yeah.
Like I know, I know the kitchen, I know what our flooring looks like, I know everything. Music, same thing, songs, albums. So reading your book was problematic on many, many fronts. Part of it is I couldn't get through a chapter without putting it down and going to Google something, to go look at an image, to whatever, and most definitely to listen to music. Like I just have to stop and be like, well, now I gotta go listen to the album.
Yeah.
I forgot about that album. So I'd like you to listen to about 45 seconds of something. You've written about this group, but I don't think you've written about this tune. And
okay.
what I'd invite you to do is just drop us in. So you hear it, what does it trigger? What does it bring up for you? How does it arise? Would you do that?
I'd love to. I was just thinking about Far Side.
They're back.
Because not only are they back, but also, so what, that song's passed me by, but the song that I am feeling most close to is a different Far Side song, which is Drop. And when I was coming up, this was in the Yo MTV Raps era, which I guess Yo MTV Raps is also back, but I don't think anyone's watching it. And this was when Yo MTV Raps and Headbangers Ball would come on MTV back to back on Fridays. And if I was lucky, my parents would, you know, I'm the youngest of four, and my older siblings are, you know, one is very close to me, but the two are like a decade older than me. What this did was created this kind of tunnel. My brother was home from Central State. He would, in the summers and springs and winter break, Friday nights, my parents would like, you could stay up because they're here. You know, you're like, we'll go to bed, we trust you with these, like, semi-parents. And we would watch Yo MTV Raps Headbang as well, and we would record, because you would have VHSs, like, of videos, because mm-hmm. The thing with that, it wasn't like the radio where you could request a song, like, the videos would play, and you would never know which one you would see or not see. And Far Side had a video called Drop, for the song Drop. Does anyone remember this song or video? I think Drop is maybe probably not even like a top three most popular Far Side song, or maybe it is. But the video is, it's backwards. And I remember waiting for that video for weeks and finally getting it and just like, what? And I remember being maybe 10 years old, 9 years old, and just frantically watching the red dot on the VCR to make sure it was still recording. This fast forwards to the present, because I was talking just this weekend with a friend about what music videos they've been into lately, you know, because I'm still a big music video person, I'm a visual person. And a lot of people offer up, like, you know, a kind of, videos aren't as inventive as they used to be anymore. And it's like, well, yeah, because videos are more artist-focused than concept-focused, mm-hmm. you know? And what I loved about Drop was that it was this really richly concept-focused video that was weird. Like, Far Side were weird, but they were also very touchable for me. And so, and also, they were a group that I remember, there were these groups when I was young. Most of my family's from New York, from the East Coast. And so we grew up loving East Coast rap to a degree that, like, I just believed every rap group was from the East Coast. And Far Side, because they kind of mapped onto that native tongues thing, this happened with Ice Cube too, you know, like, I was only, NWA was like a little before me, and my parents are vehemently not into them, so I was only vaguely familiar with NWA. And I got into Ice Cube when Ice Cube like came to the East Coast, and like the Bomb Squad was producing his joints. And so I always thought Ice Cube was like from New York. Had no idea otherwise, you know? So Farside was one of those groups where I lied to myself about where they were from, and then when I found out where they were from, it was shocking.
Sorry. So sometimes I don't even get past the intro.
Yeah.
Like, I love that. I don't even need to hear the words, but then you hear the words and it's hilarious.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, this dude is just trying to get a girl to like him. I love that. I love that he's just no shame. Like, man, I just want her to like me, but she keeps passing me by.
There's a whole era of rap, I think, in the 90s that was kind of that sort of, that level of romantic, you know? De La Soul, I feel like, was in that same kind of window.
Yeah, and even they're funny. Like, De La Soul, there's this tune on De La Soul is Dead called Pease Porridge,
yeah.
And it's a nursery rhyme.
Yeah.
And they rapped a nursery rhyme, and it's one of my favorite tunes. But again, it's because I keep pointing to Rick, like he's a musician, but it's because it's the music.
Right.
So I dare to ask this question. Can you separate the words and the music? Is there one that you just cannot live without? Because I know you love music, and I know that a lot of things are important, but can you pull it apart? Is one more important than the other?
I ideally would not like to pull it apart. My hope is that I don't have to pull it apart, but I also think now it's hard. I don't want to say anything disparaging about any rappers. Now it's hard because I think something happened in the, well, I think it's always been happening, but it's really happened now where production is just the vehicle, right? Like, production is the thing. Like, it almost doesn't matter how well someone can or cannot rap. The beat is kind of the propulsive thing. Mm-hmm. And so there are some times where the producer becomes more performer than the performer, mm-hmm. the performer that we see and hear, mm-hmm. words from at least. And so there have been a couple albums this year where I've just been like, just give me the instrumentals, man. Like, there are producers I love. I'm not naming names, so I don't want to disparage anyone, but there are a couple producers I really, really love, and sometimes I'm like, man, why are you working with him?
Yeah.
You know? And I think that's just the way of it. So in an ideal world, and there are a lot of albums, particularly this year, where I never have to do that at all, particularly rap albums. That Elzai, Georgia Ann Muldrow album is so special. Ivy Soleil's album is really special. Vel Nine's album from a couple weeks ago is really, so there's a lot of albums that don't ask me to do that, but mm-hmm. Particularly in mainstream hip hop, or like the hip hop that I still love, that is more mainstream, I do find myself being like, I don't know, the beat is working, but the flow is not, or the flow is working, but the beat's all over the place. Mm. Yeah, I don't know if, it's tough. It's tough to align the two, consistently at least.
I have a handicap only because I can't remember lyrics to save my life. You met my best friend walking in, and she constantly gives me shit about, like, what did you just say? And I'm like, wait, that's the vowel I'm singing on. I don't actually know the consonants.
Yeah.
So I'm just humming along, making up words, and I find that when the music is really good, and I hate to say this to a poet and a writer, to me, the writing, the words aren't, it's not driving my bus.
Yeah.
It's absolutely the music. And I mean, that's just my own bias, and it's neither good nor bad. It just is what it is. And it's based on my fact that I can't.
Right, yeah. I do think
the words.
If the language is performed well and almost in concert with the music, where the language itself becomes a kind of musical accompaniment. This more, I think, in like performances, you know, I think Tracy Chapman was so good at not only writing and storytelling, but her voice kind of mirroring the sounds of the guitar and filling in the spaces where there were silence that made it seem kind of, her voice was an acoustic instrument as well.
Yeah.
There are elements to that that I think fascinate me, you know, where the language is one thing, but also the performance of the language is doing something else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let's just take a left turn right now. One of my mentors I talked to last week, and we've known each other for 16 years, and I remember the first year. The first kind of advice he gave me was, Jenny, slow down.
Yeah.
Slow down. I mean, I had this gig and I had like three other jobs and I was running, racing, going. And just last week when we were on the phone, he again told me, hey, have you heard this book? It's called The Ruthless Elimination of a Hurry. And I'm like, oh my God, 16 years later, he's still telling me to slow down. And I have slowed down, definitely. I look at your creative output, not one, but two podcasts. The books of poetry, the books of prose, your organizing work. I know that there's a deeper reason why I'm constantly racing and running. And I know it's because I'm like seeking the I'm enough.
Yeah.
Like if I just do this thing, if I can show myself the world, then I feel like I'm enough. What is the thing that has you in so many different lanes? Like, you're doing so many things. What's driving that?
I think one is the reality that I think I'm just very excited about a lot of things simultaneously. And also, gratitude is a propulsive force for me. Like, I'm grateful that, you know, Object of Sound, the podcast, I have a podcast called Object of Sound where I interview musicians, essentially. And half the time, I'm like, I can't believe anyone would want to talk to me about, you know, the stuff, like, people I love. Like, we got, you know, season four started last week. And when we were planning season 4, they hit me up and they're like, hey, Bjork has a new album coming out and she really wants to talk to you about it. Cause she, you know what I mean? Like this kind of stuff where it's like,
what?
This is, so the Bjork episode is not this week, it's the week after, I think. And the same with, like, we had another thing where it was like, this was a little more inevitable, as anyone who knows my work knows a little bit, but they were like, Carly Rae Jepsen wants to talk to you about her album. You
of
know what
course,
I mean?
Yeah.
That kind of stuff was like, I have so much gratitude for being in this position. And a lot of it is fueled by the life I lived, I think, before this one. We all live many lives before the lives we are on, the lives we have. And for me, like, this was not at all a reasonable path. Like, I was in and out of court, in and out of jail. I was unhoused for a stretch in Columbus. And I don't necessarily think my life is, I don't think I am a better person now to a degree. I think I have access to live a life that does not push me towards the moments of desperation that landed me in more trouble more often than not. Mm-hmm. But I'm propelled by gratitude. You know, I really like, it's this thing I talked about earlier where this is all pleasureful work that does not pull me away from a life. It enhances my life.
Can you just share the writing as an interruption?
Yeah.
You said that earlier, and
yeah.
I was like, oh,
well,
that's great.
I was talking about how a lot of writers I talk to and know are kind of on some shit where it's like, well, I don't like writing because it pulls me away from my life, or I don't like writing because it takes me away from, you know, doing this other thing. But for me, writing has to be pleasureful to the point where it is not an interruption. It's a kind of continuation of pleasure. It's a continuation of the arc of pleasure that most days fills my life. And if it's not, in the moments it's not, I don't force anything. That's another thing. People ask, like, well, you do so much. You do, but it's also, I don't really force anything that isn't working. One thing that I think, because I say no to a lot, because one thing that I think I do, one skill that I have, is that I know the things I can do reasonably well, and I know the things I just cannot do, like the things I cannot do well. And I have no problem saying no to the things I know that I can't do well and pursuing the things that I think I could do all right. I mean, when I did this audio project called Time Machine that was about the score, the Fugees album. And I don't know, it's funny because that project, which you can listen to on whatever, it's only, I think, like 90 minutes long total. It's like
two
a side
sides.
A, side B, yeah. 45 minutes each. That was the hardest I've ever had to work at anything.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
That's the favorite thing you've ever done that I've
I'm so proud. I mean, yeah, I'm immensely proud of that thing. It took like 8.5 months to do. Like, it was the hardest thing. And there was a point, that is maybe the only point where I was like, I don't think I can do this. Like, I don't think this is possible.
Wait, you gotta say why. Why was that hard? Because it seemed, all right, we gotta put a pin in something. Why was that hard?
It was hard because not only every interview had to serve a purpose, mm-hmm. right? And so talking to, say, like, one of the interviews was like Havoc from Mobb Deep, who I had to get to, like, adequately, audibly reverse engineer a flamingo sample that shows up on a Fugees song. Mm-hmm. But people can't see him, and people can't, so it's like, listen, man, you have to explain this in the most rudimentary way possible to people who are not gonna be able to see you doing this, and people who probably don't know that flamingo song, people who maybe don't know that Fugees song. Mm-hmm. We'll have the audio, like, we'll build it in, but you have to actually talk us through this. Every interview was that rigorous,
yeah.
right? And a lot of interviews didn't make it. Like, I interviewed, like, Sly Dunbar from Jamaica, it just didn't make it. But, like, every interview was that hard, and it was the first time I had to do a project that was interview heavy and text heavy, where it was like I had to write a lot and also interview a lot. Lost Notes, the project I did before that, was all my writing, and so it was just me kind of telling stories. And so it was a hard balance, and to build out, I wanted to have a hand in it, so I, you know, to see the soundscape being built out for that.
So when you say it was hard because it was so interview heavy and you had to be so specific, did you lose the joy? Because it felt like it was like formulaic, like, no, we got to hit the beats here and here,
yeah.
And there's no, if you don't say it right, you're not telling the story.
The thing is, the joy in the interview process for me, like, I think I'm pretty good at profiles and I'm pretty good at interviews, because what I love about the interview process is that that is a space where I am most committed to being wrong about what I think something is about, right? Because I am not the actual architect of what anyone else's story is about. I have to seek the thing that brings them pleasure. A perfect example of this, to kind of only detour briefly from the score, is the beginning of the pandemic, I was sent to Nashville to profile Gillian Welch and Dave Rawlings, songwriters, brilliant, gifted people. And I had read this story about how their studio was destroyed by that tornado that hit Nashville in, I guess, early 2020, yeah? And then I read the story about how the only reason they got that studio was because a tornado had destroyed it like decades earlier, and they bought the ruins of it and rebuilt it, and then it got... And so I went to Nashville and I was like, this is a story. The story is about these two tornadoes that tore this studio apart twice. And when I got there, I kept trying to hammer away at it. And eventually Gillian was like, that's actually not that interesting to us, you know? And instead, what excited them was these stories about preserving their work, because there's a story about how when the tornado hit, the storm hit, Gillian Welch was like literally running through the streets of Nashville, her home not that far from the studio, to be clear, but like running through the streets of Nashville during the storm to get to the studio, to get to the basement, because that's where their master recordings were. And so this woman like literally risked her life to save her master recordings. That's actually, the story is not about the history, the story is about the present, yeah. Right? And so doing the score, it was hard because I could not say, I see this thing that excites you and I want to pursue it. Mm-hmm. It was kind of like, I see this thing that excites you and I need to steer you back, because yeah. The story is already written.
Yeah.
Like the story of this album as we imagine it is already built.
Yeah.
And I'm so proud of that. That was like, by far, I think the most, I don't pay attention to awards much, but it won like the, whatever the Oscar version of Best Picture is for a podcast. I don't know what those awards are called, I forget. But I'm saying that to say, I don't want these things to feel like work. I want them to feel like pleasureful detours from an already pleasureful journey.
Yeah.
And I'm lucky to have that most of the time.
You are here tonight. These people are here tonight because I have a 30-minute commute. And so it takes a little bit longer than one commute to get through one side. And I read your book, A Little Devil in America, and I was like, this is fantastic. Let me find out more. And I listened to that podcast, and I was in tears on side B when they announced, like, Whitney Houston and Sting are announcing Lauryn Hill as best album.
Yeah.
And so that just felt like, thank you. And when I got to school, or I don't remember when it was, but I sent an email to three humanities faculty, said, we're bringing him. Well, that's it.
High.
Like, have you, first of all, do you know who Hanif Abdurraqib is? And they're like, yes, dickhead, I know. You know, like, I had just brought you to the world to share with other people. So the reason why it meant so much to me is that, and your work to me is so resonant, is it feels, you write in a way, your voice, you feel familiar. And I think, I don't want that to seem insulting, like, I don't know you like that. But the way you write invites me to remember the times when I rode with my bike crew, where I had a 2-mile radius from my house, and that was my kingdom.
Yeah.
And when you write about that, I'm like, you had the same radius. Oh my God. I mean, that to me is the power of writing, is when you are just solidarity, unity, you're bringing people in. And I get a real sense of vulnerability in your writing. Like, you don't shy away from, you know, saying this hurts, this was hard. And I think a lot of people, I don't know that a lot of people would lean into that. I would like to read an excerpt of something that also blew me away. This is from there's the opening chapter, which is like a poem. Would you call it a poem, the first one?
Yeah, I would say.
And then the second one is about Soul Train. I'm not telling you. The second chapter is about Soul Train and dance marathons. And you have a real gift, man. For the last paragraph of a chapter, it's like, poof, mic drop.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you walk out of the room and don't look back. So this is the mic drop for me. And I think this is how I would most like to imagine romance, friends, or should I say lovers. In praise of all my body can and cannot do, I wish to figure out how it can best sing with all of yours for a moment in a room where the walls sweat. I wish to lock eyes across a dance floor from you while something our mother sang in the kitchen plays over the speakers. I want us to find each other among the forest of writhing and make a deal. Okay, lover, it is just us now. The only way out is through. Damn. That is powerful, and that is, to me, just incredibly, incredibly vulnerable. And to me, great art, there cannot be great art without vulnerability.
I don't think there can be, for me at least, there can't be like great living without vulnerability. I find myself, which to be clear, like, there are a few thoughts I have on that, and I won't bore everyone with them, but one of them is that, like, I am also very aware of the fact that, not that, and this is like not saying that you or anyone else should not classify qualifying work as vulnerable. I do think I'm predisposed to feeling large things very easily, very quickly, and have access to my emotions that I think are pretty open. And my therapist has tried to do this thing where I say and instead of but to, just thinks it'll raise my level of optimism, which I think, though it has helped me communicate, so we'll see. And I am also aware that, like, the critical response to my work and the just communal response to my work as rich in vulnerability, that being a hallmark of it, I also know that a part of that, at least, it is about the work being vulnerable, but there is some part of it that I think makes me consider the fact that, like, I'm a straight man, and there are tones in my work that are vulnerable, but here's what I'll say. The poet Rachel McKibbins has this great quote about how, like, poets who are not straight men or writers who are not straight men are expected to be vulnerable. And for those of us who are straight men, it's like a surprise or a gift. And so I think I also had to learn to access vulnerability in a very hard way because I was not a vulnerable person growing up. And I was a very, like, emotionally quieted person growing up because I didn't know how to access my emotions well. My mother passed away when I was going from eighth grade to ninth grade, which is just like, I don't think there's any good time to lose someone you love deeply, especially not someone who is, my mother was very pivotal in the kind of building and making of my emotional landscape. Not to say that my father's not an emotionally aware man, but we had a different relationship. Mm-hmm. And so it was a bad time because I was crossing over this threshold of from childhood to very, like, very extreme teenage life. And I felt very lost. And I think my response to that was to fold into a world where I made my emotions as small as possible because I always felt a little strange for having access to very big feelings, mm-hmm. right? I was often made to feel like that was an oddity. And so I think there's a part of me that returns to vulnerability in my work and in my living because for me, vulnerability is also the art of reaching out into an expanse and asking someone to reach back towards you. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work every time, but I do think that I don't want people to leave any reading or talk of mine and be feeling emotionally bereft or feeling like they did not access something that made them feel. Mm-hmm. Because I am always kind of rubbing up against the potential for really big feeling. Mm-hmm. And I think growing to a point where I got comfortable enough to express that is the place I'm always in, has been really important for me, not just as a writer, but as a person who at least tries to be emotionally aware and tries to be tender within the relationships that I build. You know, I talked earlier, I think in the class about, or maybe this morning, I don't know, I talked earlier about like seeing men be affectionate with each other when I was young, mm-hmm. through hip hop especially. Like in the book I write about Ghostface and Raekwon, like Raekwon kissing Ghostface on the cheek in the Triumph video. Mm-hmm. But also through sports, I loved, growing up, I loved the Fab Five, like Michigan's basketball team. Yeah. I just rewatched the documentary on them because I'm working on a thing on them for the new book. And they just like were always all over each other. Mm-hmm. Like they loved each other. These dudes who like did not know, well, Chris Webber and Jalen Rose knew each other, but the other three, they didn't know each other until they got to Michigan. And then they just spent 2 years like always with their arms around each other. Mm-hmm. And to see that, and to desire that kind of affection from a very young age, I feel like, and then to not have really a world where that felt tenable for me or possible for me, because of the failure and the clutches of the limits of masculinity in our youth and until our adulthood. Now I feel like I can't deny myself that anymore, right?
Okay, so there I think is the answer to the potential question. You say you reach out and hope someone reaches back.
Yeah.
Well, there are going to be a lot of times in life where someone doesn't reach back, where you put yourself out there and then, you know, it doesn't come through. How do you know you just have to keep doing it? How do you dance that dance so that you can stay safe? You can't always be putting yourself out and getting rejected.
No, trust me. I definitely can't keep, I'm actually bad at rejection. I'm terrible at rejection. I'm notoriously bad at, not even like, I'm good at, I just gave a talk in the class about like rejection in a professional sense. I'm great at rejection in a professional sense. I actually don't really care. Like I could turn in a book and have it turned down by every publisher in the country and I'd be like, okay, you know, I guess I'll just work on another thing. But personal rejection is really hard for me, right? And I think a part of it is because, slightly veer into vanity a bit, but I grew up with two siblings, one who went here and another, two brothers. I have three siblings and two brothers. And my two brothers are both like very, very, very good looking dudes. My one was like a literal football star, like all-star football player. And I just was like not them. And so for a lot of my life, I was kind of isolated and afraid of entering the world in a personal way or like allowing myself space in any kind of personal way, because I was like, these dudes are cool and everyone loves them. Like they were so richly beloved. And I was just like kind of the weird youngest brother who would stay in the room with headphones on. And so I never actually built, it's funny now if I ever see myself referred to as like charismatic or, because that's not something I earned organically. I didn't build that up organically. I think I just built it through a lot of trial and error as an adult. But I do think rejection, even temporarily, personal rejection sends me back to like, do very quickly and harshly revert back to like the kid with headphones in a very literal sense. The last breakup I had, you know, I was very much back in my room with headphones. So there's a very literal, I'm not being like hypothetical, there's a very literal chart back to my younger self. But the difference now is I've really made peace with my own company, too, you know? I think that I was, for so much of my life, I was lonely out of necessity and not preference, or I imagined myself lonely out of necessity and not preference. Now I believe myself to be comfortably isolated sometimes due to preference of, I've gotten this hard-earned preference with my own company that I've built up. Does this mean that every time I put myself out to the world, if there's nothing that returns that feels comfortable for me, am I happy? No, but I am a lot better at saying, this will be okay, because I'm all right with myself, you know?
It's nice getting older.
It is. I think that's it. I mean, a lot of it is getting older, and a lot of it's just like, I don't know, you know? We don't have to talk about my dating life, but I remember like
I mean by all means if
recently
you want to.
Recently I went on a date that didn't really go well, and it didn't go well definitely because we disagreed on a poet's body of work, but which for me wasn't a problem, but I think for this person it was more of a problem.
Wow, you run with a different crowd.
Yeah, it was wild. Honestly, for me I was like, listen, I don't really. It was Mary Oliver. Who I love Mary Oliver.
Boy, this is
like
a very Mary Oliver friendly
group. Yeah, like listen.
Watch yourself.
I love Mary Oliver. Like literally I keep books by my nightstand and I usually rotate them out. The only book that never leaves is Thirst by Mary Oliver. Yeah. I love Mary Oliver. and this person and I disagreed on Mary Oliver's body work. And for me, I was like, you know, I gotta be honest, I don't care. Like, I mean, or at least I don't care to the point where this is like a hindrance. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. And I remember going home afterwards, and I was like, damn, that didn't go well. You know, I could tell it didn't go well. Like, the phone's definitely not ringing on this one, you know what I mean? But, you know, if you play ball, if you like play basketball, sometimes you shoot a shot and it feels good and you know it's going in, and sometimes you're like, ooh, that's missing everything.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? So that was one of the ones where I was like,
nope.
Not hitting the rim, you know? But it was one of those things where I got home and I was like, I actually still, though, I feel like that could happen 100 times over and I could still come home to this life I've built in part through this emotional awareness that I've cultivated through not only my work, but through like a lifetime of listening to myself and what my needs are, and I think I'd be okay.
Yeah.
And so some of this just has to do with the world I've built where I'm comfortable with myself, for better or worse, sometimes too comfortable.
Mm.
There are times where I have to be motivated to leave the house at this point.
Yeah. So speaking of home, so we've had an opportunity to just chat a little bit in between car rides and doing everything. So I told you I'm from Guam.
Yeah.
My parents,
yeah.
My people are from Guam. And you met my best friend who came in from Milwaukee. Today. And that's where I grew up. And I have a very complicated relationship with home. So ethnically, home is far, far away.
Yeah.
Where I grew up is a place that I am deeply devoted to. I feel a lot of connection to Milwaukee. And then now this is, I've actually lived in Ohio longer than I've lived anywhere else, which is weird when you go to that tipping point
Oh,
I've been here longer than in my own hometown.
Yeah.
I really struggled growing up where I grew up because I wasn't like anyone else. And everyone else was white and blonde hair, blue eyes, slender frame. Not this.
Yeah.
So I had a hard, during those formative years where you're just like trying to like figure out who you are and why you are a part of something or belong to something, I wasn't there.
Yeah.
And it took me a lot of time to get there. So when you think of home and you think of community and belonging, what do you require? What makes something home for you? Because I know you came home to Columbus, you came back.
Yeah, I lived in New Haven, Connecticut for like 2.5 years. I did not like it at all. Sorry if anyone here is from Connecticut. Bad time for me. Good time for others, I'm sure. Very bad time for me. And for me, I require malleability and forgiveness. Community, I think a lot of times people mistake places where community can be found and fostered for community in itself. Community is an active, one has to actively participate in the making and fostering of community and growing of community and tending to and caring for community. I can't be like, people are always like, well, you know, the writing community. And it's like, what's the writing community can't be any motherfucker who's written a book because surely one of them Trump kids got a book. So that ain't, you know, sorry. We aren't of the same community. And so for me, community requires a sense of saying, I am accountable to you and you are accountable to me. And that accountability is born out of affection. Mm-hmm. I don't want to let you down. And so I am present with you. And I don't want to see you let anyone else down. If you are someone who does organizing work, you know really well the kind of slog of it. Every year I help organize this Eid letter writing campaign to incarcerated Muslims, right? And there is a point where it just becomes hard. I mean, anyone who organizes something that takes like more than 4 months even to organize knows that there is a window where it's like, this is no longer, like the excitement from the like, we're doing this, wears off.
Yeah.
And then it's just like capital W work, right? And how else do you get through that if you are not in a real, active, viable community that sees you beyond what you can produce? You know, someone that is like, we are working on this together, but also, how are you holding up?
Yeah.
You know, like, how are you doing? Because this is hard. Community, you know, I came up on the punk scene in the Midwest, Columbus, but, you know, kind of traversed the Midwest. And something that was so vital for me on those scenes, you know, the punk kids I rolled with were like mostly black kids or, you know, mostly like queer black kids who sometimes would not fare as well, the pit, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But we also just like knew we had each other's back. It was an unspoken thing. The thing about community is no one, it works best when no one has to ask if you need something. They know they're there, you know, you're present. There's an unspoken communication born out of a deep knowing. And that's why I came home when I decided I needed to leave Connecticut. That's why I came home. I wanted to go somewhere where I was known. I wanted to go somewhere where people actually did not care if I wrote anything ever again. Mm-hmm. Or people who are deeply proud of me but don't like need my accomplishments to see me as full. The day, I guess about a year ago, the day the MacArthur was announced, I was, there was a concert I was going to, and I was late to pick up my friend, because my friend was coming with me. I was late, I was like 25, 30 minutes, very late for me. I'm not the most punctual person in the world, but I'm like one of those people who like, I'm late in a 5 minute window, never more than like a 10 minute window. More than a 10 minute window, I start to feel too guilty. More than a 10 minute window, I'll probably cancel. but I was like 25 minutes late, and she got in the car, and I was like, oh, you know, like the first thing in my head was like, oh, I don't know if you noticed, I don't know if you saw the news, but like today they announced this really big thing that I won, and she put her hand on my leg, and she's like, I'm very proud of you. You're 25 minutes late. And that was a really grounding thing for me, you know, like it was, especially on that day where everyone's relation to me was, you've achieved something.
Yeah.
It was good to have a friend who I knew loved me and was proud of me, but was also like, you
screw
know,
you.
You said you'd be here and we're gonna miss the opener. Like this person really wants to see the opener of the concert. I was also into the opener, but that kind of thing. I want to go to a place where community in me does not define one by what they produce, defines a person by who they are or who they're trying to become. And I am someone who is constantly in the act of becoming, and I need grace. My dear friend Angel Nafis, the poet, brilliant poet, said this thing like 3 weeks ago where she was like, I don't even know if I deserve grace, but I need it. Mm. Like, I don't even know if I'm at a point where like, I don't really know if I want to be the arbiter of whether or not I deserve grace, but I know I require it. Mm-hmm. And that was really propulsive for me. Because yeah, like, most days I would like to say I deserve grace, because I think many of us do. But even on the days where I'm like, I'm actually not sure if I feel up for being deserving of people's grace, I still need it. I still need people who are gonna say, I'm willing to offer you this. You know, mm-hmm. I think that is, to me, that is how a home is built. A home is built upon a foundation of a capacity for grace.
So are you home now in Columbus?
Yeah, very much. It's interesting because, I live in this neighborhood that's like one of the historically black neighborhood. Is anyone from Columbus at all? Only one person, wow. I live in a neighborhood called Bronzeville, which is like the last, you know, vestige of historical black Columbus, or one of them, that is currently being gentrified as all things are. But I live in this neighborhood where I am the youngest person on my block, and I think on the next block's over, and I'm like the only like single adult person. It's just like me alone with my dog in my house. And most people on the block are like elder black folks, folks who have lived there for like 10, 20, 30, in some cases even 40 years. And I'm so overwhelmed always by how there's just never any, there's so much affection present. You know, there was a point last winter where I was just, quite frankly, like too depressed to go outside, you know? Winter in Columbus, in Ohio in general, like the tail end of it is just really not my thing.
Won't end.
Like when it, yeah, you know, when like in March when it's still snowing, I'm like, enough. And it snowed one day in March and I was just like, I cannot bring myself, you know, I'm one of those people who like shovels out of guilt and out of obligation. Like I'll look out my window and see that my neighbors, but I also, because I live in a place with elders and some people like use the sidewalks and with wheelchairs and things like, I shovel, and there was that one day in March where I was like, I just do not feel like I can get out of bed. And I looked out the window and I had seen my neighbor 2 days earlier and I told her and her partner, like, you know, I'm just like not, I've been feeling kind of bummed out lately, you know, it's just like the winter's weighing on me. And this day I looked out my window and I just saw her husband out there with the snowblower. Like it wasn't even spoken, I didn't ask him to do that, had he not done that, I would have probably gotten out of bed and done it eventually. But it was cool that this person who's like, you know, many years my senior and is not beholden to me in any way, mm-hmm. other than the fact that we live on the same street, was like, I know that you're struggling, so I'm gonna do this for you. on the other side of that, my neighborhood is so, yeah, I don't know. Shortly after I moved in, like a year after I moved in, this thing had happened where these young kids came through the neighborhood, and we have a little pocket park in the middle of our street, and they went to the park, and they were being rambunctious but not threatening. For some reason, like playing really loud music, cursing really loud, whatever, and this thing had jumped off where, you know, one of my neighbors came out of the house and she was like, hey, can y'all, you know, you don't gotta leave, but can you turn the music down and maybe stop, you know, it's like 8 o'clock at night, you know, like, you know, maybe chill out with the language a little bit or just quiet down. And they kind of like started wilding out. They started like yelling at her and all this stuff. And, you know, for me, she was like clearly in distress. And I was like, all right, well, no one's gonna call the cops on these kids, right? Like, that's just not the way my street operates. Like, no one's gonna call cops on these young folks who aren't being. And so I remember I went outside. I used to, like, I'm the youngest and, like, hippest person in the neighborhood to my advantage, you know? I was like, all right, this is my time to shine, you know what I mean? So I went outside and, like, just talked to them. I could do that because I was that kid, right? Yeah. Like, I was that kid who would just be rambunctious because I could. And so there's a real relationship. There's something interesting about a neighborhood that also is kind of a living, breathing community, mm-hmm. where we have kind of a set of rules based through, or not even a rules, but like this contract built through affections. Yeah. And I do feel most home there, yeah.
Oh, that's beautiful. So I want to ask you one last question, do a little activity, if you will, and then we'll open it up to a Q&A. So what's bringing you joy right now?
My latest obsession is album cover outtakes. I get these obsessions where they don't really align with anything I'm writing or that I, you know, but one day I was looking at these, there's a punk band named The Damned, and they have an album called Damn, Damn, Damned, and on the album cover, they're covered in like cream from cake and pie. And I just was curious, like, surely there are outtakes from this photo shoot. And I found the outtakes, and they're just like, it's like the series of outtakes are so wild because it's like chronologically, you can see the pictures where the band are like looking at the cake and realizing they can throw them on each other. And then there's pictures where they're just like throwing these cakes on each other. And so I told a friend who's a photographer, like, oh, I'm into this. And she was like, I got something for you. And she sent me this massive folder of album outtake photos broken down by decades, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s.
These are her photographs?
No, they're not her. She just has an archive of them.
Oh.
And I knew she had some. I reached out to her because I knew she had like a few. And I was like, if you ever run into any spare ones, you know, just send them my way. I would love to see them. And she was like, oh, I've got a lot. And she sent me this folder and like, talking like Whitney Houston's debut album cover outtakes, you know, like the last Aaliyah album, the outtakes are just so stunning, you know? So that's bringing me a lot of joy. I'm still like working through them slowly. When Olivia Newton-John passed, it's wild because the night before I was looking at the Grease album cover outtakes and just marveling at the palpable chemistry between her and John Travolta, where they're just like, even in the outtakes, they're having so much fun with each other, you know? So that's bringing me a lot of pleasure because it's like, you know, you get to see people being silly before the... You get to see the product of pleasure before the final product. Yeah. Queen, like the sheer heart attack album outtakes are just so funny. Like to see Freddie Mercury, who I think does not get enough credit for being playful. I actually don't really like Queen's music all that much, sorry. But if anyone here is a very big Queen fan, I don't like the tunes that much. I'm always like, my friends kill me on this, but I'm always like, Bohemian Rhapsody, maybe 4 minutes too long.
Fair.
So like a That's lot fair. Of Queen songs, I'm like, fellas, just like an editor would have helped. And then like the Queen songs I do like are the ones that are kind of like, I love Fat Bottom Girls, but also when I listen to it, I'm like, fuck, man, this is a little bit cringe-inducing, but you know, I love it. But yeah, so that's bringing me a lot of joy right now. Also. I'm slowly restoring. I got this 1930s jukebox in my house that I don't really know how to fix, but I got it in 2019. And the thing was, I'm gonna work on this. And then the pandemic hit and I never worked on it, and now I'm working on it. And I don't know what I'm doing, but for the first time yesterday, I got like one of the chambers to light up and like
That's exciting.
Pull a record up. And so I was like, oh, I truly don't know what I'm doing. Like, right? Literally, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm like watching YouTube videos and just screwing things and unscrewing things. And so maybe by 2035, it'll play records if we don't all sink under the collapse of the planet.
Oh, God. You're bringing me back to 2020 right now. Please don't. All right, so the last thing I want to do is value quantity over quality.
Yeah.
All right. Didn't bring my readers. Bad idea. All right. Favorite podcast?
Weirdly, I actually don't listen to podcasts.
What?
I rarely listen to podcasts. I don't even know. I have never listened to an episode of my own podcast. I don't know what Object Sound sounds like. I know people like it, which is cool.
Oh, my gosh.
But okay, wait. But there is one.
Not what I expected.
I really am not a podcast listener.
Wait, let me ask you this. Is it because you're so consumed by music? You
yeah,
just don't have the bandwidth,
But I also just think, like, I don't know. I don't be liking to listen to people talk if I don't know them all like that.
But you do that with people.
But I mean, in this setting, of course, I loved it. But I mean, like, but I will say this. There is a podcast that I loved a couple years ago. The writer, Patrick Radden Keefe, who's just, I adore his work, and I think he's rigorous in ways that he had this podcast called Wind of Change, okay, about how the Scorpion song Wind of Change was most possibly written by the CIA to help tear down the Berlin Wall. And that shit was like, it really had me in a wild place. Like, especially because I think it ends with this thing where he's like, and there are other songs the CIA has written that you probably know really well. And I was like, I don't need to hear that. I was hitting people up. I had it in my head for a long time that the CIA wrote Weezer's My Name is Jonas. And I like could not, like I was like, the CIA wrote this to like upend the labor movement. Okay. And I could not shake that. I was thinking about it all. I felt bad. I felt like that meme, that conspiracy meme with the dude with all the like threads in the background. I was that guy, because I was telling everyone, like, here's how I know the CIA wrote this. There was like a whole list. I at one point I thought the CIA wrote Macklemore's Same Love, which, you know.
Oh boy. Okay, the CIA is gonna watch this on YouTube.
Yeah.
You should probably.
Well, that podcast, Wind of Change, is incredible. Part of it is because Patrick's such a great storyteller, and he's just such a rigorous researcher. Mm. Like, he is just so. There was this photo. I don't know if anyone knows Patrick Radden Keefe's work, but he wrote this book called Say Nothing that is so good about the troubles in Ireland. His most recent book's called Empire of Pain, about the Sacklers and the opioid crisis. But he's like notorious for being this like rigorous worker and researcher. And like 2 weeks ago, whenever the US Open was, his wife, he posted this picture that his wife took of him at the US Open, literally the US Open, where he had like a notepad and he was researching researching a project at the US Open that had nothing to do with tennis. He's just like doing work at the US Open. I was like, gosh, like, I'm maybe never going to be that intense with it.
Okay.
Sorry, that was a longer
That's
answer.
That's okay, yeah, we do need to be moving.
Rapid fire, all right, let's go.
A little more. Most memorable live show?
There are a lot. The one that comes to mind now, I once saw Big Crit play in his hometown of Meridian, Mississippi. And I'm big on seeing people play at home. And this was before Big Crit got bigger. It was before, like, you know, maybe even before the first record came out. He had mixtapes out. And he played this song, Hometown Hero, which is a beautiful song. It samples Adele's Hometown Glory. And I just remember being there with these people who, like, knew and loved him and knew that he was on the verge of something great. And it felt like we were all going with him. You know, like, he felt like he was ascending and we were all coming.
Thank you. Book you won't shut up about?
Marianne Chan's poetry book, All Heathens.
Favorite meal of the day?
Probably dinner, I guess, but only because, I don't know, like, I'm such a routine. My breakfast is normally just like a bad piece of toast and a bunch of water because I need something to get me propelling to my run. No, lunch. I like lunch because it's a disruption of, like, I usually do lunch like post-shower, post-run, post-run, post-shower, and it's like, that actually feels to me like the first meal of the day.
Okay. Current song you're listening to on repeat?
Jacob Banks' Here Lies the Man Who Never Changed.
TV show you're watching right now?
I am watching a few, but I'm currently rewatching Schitt's Creek because I realized that somehow I never saw the entire last season. I thought I did, and then someone was talking to me about it, and I was like, I never saw any of that. What are you talking about? That happened? So I'm currently like rewatching from like season three on, so I could, and I'm also watching, I love Girlfriends, the show, not, I mean, broadly, I've had girlfriends I've loved, but the show Girlfriends, I've been, ever since that came on streaming, I've been slowly rewatching it because I just love that show. There's an era of black sitcom I love after what some would consider perhaps a golden era of black sitcom, but, you know, I adore like Living Single and Girlfriends, and I watch those all the time.
Raiders of the Lost Ark or Temple of Doom?
Temple of Doom.
Ooh,
sure.
That was quick.
Yeah.
Gandalf or Dumbledore?
Who's Gandalf? I don't know who Gandalf is. Dumbledore is the Harry Potter one, right? Correct. I hear he's bad. I don't really know much about Harry Potter.
Let's move on to the next one. Okay.
I feel like the less I know about Harry Potter, the better.
Barack or Michelle?
I don't know. They're both fine without my endorsement.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Rachel.
I really appreciate this.
Thanks, everyone. Wait, who is Gandalf, though? Is Gandalf, what's Gandalf?
That's Lord of the Rings.
Got it. Sorry, that's like outside of the realm of my...
All good.
All right. I want to thank you for that conversation. I'd like to invite anyone who would like to ask Tanith a question to line up at the microphone, which is right here.
Can I say, too, that I've been saying this all day, and you can ask me questions about whatever. It doesn't have to be writing. It can be like what we do. We talk about pop culture or music or sneakers or food or Ohio, whatever.
So that's the, so yeah.
That's the disclaimer.
So like you said, I also like to draw your attention to the QR code that's on the inside of the cover of your program. Please take a picture with your phone and answer the brief 8-question survey.
Eight?
You need any? Yeah, 8 questions.
That's not brief.
It's a little quick one. If you need any help, ask your neighbor or one of the ushers, which is probably only me. No? Any questions? Anybody that want to come up here and ask any questions?
All right, so I have a question for you. We were kind of talking about like the visual and the music of your writing. One thing I noticed while I was reading it is like the breakup of the stanzas and the pauses and all of those. So like, is that what, like, are you thinking about rhythm when you're doing those breaks?
Yeah, I think the shape the work takes on the page is also an act of building that kind of rhythmic instrumentation, that feeling of, you know, I read the work in a certain way, but I can also ask a reader to read it in a certain way, if it arrives to them in a certain way, formatted a certain way. And so when I think about space, white space in particular, I think about white space is almost the breaks between instruments in a way. And so, yeah, so much of my formatting of a poem is mostly just asking people to read it in the way that I imagined it.
And then I also was wondering, I know in the earlier session, a student had asked you if you were ever interested in like doing a collab with anyone, and you talked about how your writing process is just kind of problematic and you don't think it would work. So it kind of made me wonder, well, what exactly is your writing process?
Well, I think, I don't know about it's problematic, it's just like highly conducive to me and the rigorous nature of my work. I'm kind of like a bulk writer in a small window of time. Like I write a lot of words in a small window of time and I get really hyper-focused on that. Like I don't, you know, there's always this year's, the first draft was like 108,000 words and I wrote it in like 3 months. And I think the pace at which I work is very good for me, but it's not really good for everyone.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Anybody else want to come up and ask any questions? We've got one more. And then if there's more questions, you can all just come line up at the podium while other people are asking.
So this year I'm starting speech and debate, and I'm doing a speaking event. Do you have any advice for how to be a better speaker?
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Speech and debate is tough. I tried speech and debate and was not good at it. But So this is, take this with a grain of salt. But I often think that, you know, like, not in a manipulative way, but I've gotten so good at speaking on my own terms. I'm a very patient speaker. I'm a very, like, slow speaker, but it's because I'm often trying to think of a way that I can very quickly get to the thing that I know I believe with conviction. Sometimes I surround that with stuff that I am perhaps more flimsy on than I'd like to be, but there's always something that I know I believe deeply with conviction, and I think so much of my outward speaking and so much of that is just building a pathway, the fastest pathway I can to get to the thing that I know I believe and can stand on my like stand firm on 2 feet and say. But speech and debate is hard. I wish you luck.
Thank you.
All right. Any more?
Yes.
Hey.
Hey, hey.
So it's not really a question, it's more of an invitation. I'm the treasurer of Illmatic Expression. It is the poetry, spoken word, and creative arts club on campus. I'm sorry, I'm a little short.
Me too.
There we go. I'm like, am I being heard? But we are having our first big event of the year, Maroon Lounge, this Thursday at 6 p.m. It's 3 hours long. It's 3 hours long. Let me know if y'all can hear me. But if you would like to come, it would be great to have you there. We have some great poets in our club.
It's like a spoken word event?
Yeah, it's spoken word, music, people. It's really an all arts club, but we do have a lot of poetic speakers and instrumentalists that I think really might spark your fancy.
Very cool. Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I definitely know Illmatic Expressions. They are a great organization, great poetry.
Very cool.
Yep. Any more people want to come ask questions? Yep.
Hey, what's up, man? Good to see you.
Good to see you, too. I'm actually not going to ask you to come over to the Dayton Poetry Slam, but...
I would. I love my time there.
But I wanted to ask
you... Is it on
you.
Sundays still?
Yeah, first and third.
Yeah.
But I wanted to ask you about something, because, you know... all the features I've seen, you did something, and you've done it both times, that I've never seen anybody else do. You just called everybody up to the stage and kind of just sat there like story time.
Yeah.
And talked about what sparked that idea. Like, I'm going to bring up the entire audience and change the whole dynamic of it.
Yeah, I don't do that anymore, mostly because, you know, people being that close to each other now.
So, well, yeah, right.
But I loved doing that. I did that. The first time I ever did that was because I was performing somewhere, maybe 2015, and the microphone stopped working. Like, the electricity just went out. But I was like, well, I still want to finish reading. And I realized that doing that changes the architecture of a space, not only the physical architecture, but the emotional architecture. It calls people in, it calls people close. Physically calling people close allows for, I think, this kind of radiant interaction, this reminder that we're all kind of present in the same space and all capable of feeling something, though not the same thing. What I love about a concert, for example, is that I know that I'm deeply feeling something alongside many other people who are also feeling something, though it's likely different than what I'm feeling. Mm-hmm. And I think like getting people physically closer maybe brings those frequencies a little bit more on the same level. You know, and so I adored that practice. I abandoned it, pandemic had me abandon it, but
right.
I do love, that practice, that was a hallmark of mine for a long time because there's something I really admire and adore about physical closeness and not feeling distant. It also is just like the punk ethos I came up with. Like I came up seeing punk shows in basements where the bands were like this close to the, there was no real hierarchy of performer and audience. Everyone was performer and everyone was audience. And even now, there are small ways where I try to, like notoriously, I don't sit behind a table when I sign books. I just stand up and talk to people and walk through the line. The stage is a place of power and it's a place of all these, but I think the way to deconstruct what the stage represents, I think is important. And so that was one of those modes, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Anybody else need? We're all good. All right, so thank you so much for your questions. Can we get one more round of applause for Hanif?
Thank you. Thank you all so much. Thank you.
All right, Half Price Books will be selling A Little Devil in America at 20% discount. We invite you to purchase a book if you don't already have one as soon as we wrap up. Hanifa will be signing books outside the ballroom. I actually think it's in the back of the ballroom. So thank you all again for coming out, and we appreciate you all.